talk, or I might, my charge for this, talk to you a little bit about opera strategies, the CP and how we handle it, how we manage it. So, you know, again, Amy and I work at Texas Center for House of Children. It's a great place for us because we're able to, you know, one day when a child comes, they can be evaluated by neurology. Amy for, or one of our partners for Logan and the members of our service. So it's really good, and I think we get a lot of good sort of cohesive care that way. You know, out of interest, I know you guys know a lot about CP, but I don't know if you know about the history of it. So a lot of it's made of it now because of media and, you know, Google and all that stuff. But if you actually go back in history, so in the Egyptian, ancient Egypt and stuff, Pharaoh Sipto, they way back in BC, he actually had what looks like CP, as we call CP. He's got, you know, sort of the lines formed of the foot as well as in the hand. And so you can see it all throughout history. And Hippocrates, which, you know, all of us sort of take as a, now as a called Hippocratic oath, you know, arm of graduate medical school, he was actually one that way back again in BC talked about it, talked about the etiology of CP, really, you know, saying that 8 months from this, they discussed prematurity, congenital infection, and stress. You know, prenatal is related to the pathogenesis of brain damage. And then even Claudius Nero back in AD, way back in Greece, had the same sort of, you know, sort of positioning that suggests that he had CP also. So CP itself, right, is a diagnosis that started off by being called Little's disease, because this was a surgeon in England who actually commented on the typical arbitrary positioning that existed, and that was in 1862, and they called it Little's disease for quite some time until this gentleman, Osler, who was in Johns Hopkins University up in Maryland, who started it, one of the founders of the term cerebral palsy. That's why he came to this term cerebral palsy from then on. You know, Sigmund Freud, who you hear a lot of things about, also had a lot to do with CP. And in fact, terms that we use right now, today, are actually started by him. So timing of when the injury happened, so was it antepartum, intrapartum, postpartum? And he documented actually what we see, which is really sometimes a poor correlation between the clinical symptoms and what the actual lesion is in the brain when they do an MRI. And then he contributed really extensively to talking about movement disorders in children. We know from other reasons, you know, Freudian slips and things like that. But he actually was a very great man and about to do a lot of medicine that we do today. So what do we talk about in terms of upper or lower extremity reasons? It's really a disorder, sort of motor control, can have some sensibility problems and also some intellectual problems. For us, as an upper extremity, it's very difficult when we see them initially as infants to say sometimes that you have CP because, you know, they show up and it's hard to evaluate if they have primitive reflexes there and they're too long. What their tone is sometimes is difficult as children. So sometimes when they're infants, it's hard to tell, as you know, and you don't really know until they're a little bit older. Just to kind of go over a little bit of different types, because for us, I think it's a little bit different than Amy in the lower extremity. There's certain types for us that we feel are good operative candidates or something that we should try to entertain. And it would be sort of this what's called the spastic type. The ones that I'll show you here have good volitional control. So if you look at this child, he's got right hemiparesis, spastic hemiparesis, and so, but he's actually got great volitional control on the right. So if there was anything you could do for him to try to improve his positioning for use, it would be wonderful. And so these children are great to sort of modify, sort of do some surgery for. And we're gonna look at this video later, so we'll just kind of go on. And that's versus a type that's called athetoid or dystonic, sort of either really rigid or somewhere. For us, the arm sort of looks possessed, you know, sort of moves like in all directions and not very good control. And for us, those are usually not great surgical candidates because if we do tendon transfers or stretch it out, it's very hard to rehab those children. So if you wanted to look at an example of that, you can just see right there, you know, just you get that feeling when you're trying to extend that elbow, do that extremity, just how tight and how rigid it is. And even if you, on these children, if you have them on baclofen or something else, they're still so rigid that it's very difficult to sort of improve their position and make them much more functional than they are. Sometimes putting them in a different position for the wrist will help, but as far as tendon transfers to really improve this position, it's tough. You can kind of get that impression from him. This is sort of more about the position that they're using. But so as opposed to, you know, the lower extremities, which is that GMFCS, which is, you know, zero is the best and five is the worst, just to confuse everything, we use something in the upper extremity called the house classification, which eight is the best and zero is the worst. So just to be, I mean, just to confuse it. But basically, what the way you think about this is, like, if you're at the 0-1 level, you know, what we call about assist is, if you look at the children, if they try to use it in some fashion, whether it's even holding a tray like this or trying to use it as assist, that's what we call sort of a passive assist, where they use the active assist, they really are getting in there and trying to use it. It's just their positioning is really affecting how they use it. That's one thing. And then sort of that 7-8 is they have really good spontaneous use and just a little bit of deformity. And so the 7 and 8 are pretty rare. The majority of the children are sort of somewhere in here, the 3, 4, 5, and 6. So it always comes up, so what's therapy about? What's Botox about? And finally, what's surgery about? And I don't know how, you know, as far as what you know about therapy, and, you know, depending on where you are, therapy is a really important adjunct. And so I was actually curious about it because you hear so many things about patients when they come in, therapists saying that they want to do this or that. You know, what's the evidence? And is there good evidence to it? And so the best paper I found was actually in 2014. So it's a review of 42 studies, so called meta-analysis, where they looked at 113 upper extremity approaches. The inclusion type criteria for these were that they have 0 to 18 years old with unilateral CP. They had evaluated sort of non-surgical upper extremity therapy or adjunctive therapy in combination for these children. And so they measured, you know, everything's sort of measured with outcome studies. So the outcomes are measured with either upper extremity unimanual or bimanual capacity and performance of important things like individual goals or self-care skills. And so what the, not to bore with everything, but so the bottom line was they found that modest evidence that intensive activity-based goal-directed interventions, sort of constrained by manual training, are more effective than standard care in improving upper extremity individualized outcomes. And I think we've sort of found that, as Scott is right, because we actually have now, our OTs run a constrained camp in the summer, and I think they've had, you know, I was never really a believer in it early on, like probably 6, 7, 8, 10 years ago, of constrained therapy, because I thought it was kind of torture for the children. I really did. My OTs and two or three of them that just specialize in upper extremity have actually made me a believer, I think, as far as something that's not going to hurt the child and actually can help.
Can you expand on that a little bit? Like, what do you mean by constrained therapy, and what do you mean by standard care? Do you mean like an intensive therapy program tends to be more effective than your periodic?
In your period, correct.
Okay.
Correct. So intensive therapy. Now, the question is, how long does it last, right? So if you stop that, does it go away? I don't think we know that, right? But when, and so that's the one thing. Constraint therapy really is they sort of take the good arm and they really hold it.
So like at Scottish, right, they have a camp called Pirate Camp,
right?
And the kids come for a week, and I think they come from like 8 in the morning to like 4 p.m. every day. And what they do is they take the good hand and they like...
They just bind it.
They bind it with a cast or like almost like an oven mitt, and they force them for the entire day, for an entire week, to use the other hand. And then they test them, like at the beginning of the week and the end of the week, and they can prove dramatic improvements in the hand that has the contractures by just forcing them not to use their quote-unquote good hand.
And I want to say, my son actually went to Scottish Rite's Constraint Camp this summer, and he's 9 and a half, and can I tell you, telling him ahead of time we were going to do this, he was like, oh my god, I cannot believe you're going to force me to do it. He came home from the first day glowing about how much fun they had. Like, they do an amazing job of making it fun.
It's like so fun, but they're doing fun stuff. It's crafts really and toys, stuff. And but the whole time they're using the contractor.
Yeah, it was amazing, but it's got to be fun, because, man, I don't think you could have made him go back.
And it's a tough deal, I think. But, you know, it's been shown, I mean, this is one thing when they looked at all these studies, shown that it helps. Now, once it's over and 3 years down the line, it'll help. Nobody really knows that. At least early evidence-based, as far as we know, it helps. And so that was back in 2014. I thought it was interesting, because I was always sort of on the fence about whether constraints should be done. But I think in that setting, where they do it where it's fun, it's good for the kids. And Botox is always a big thing, so... I'm not sure if you talk about Botox.
I did not. But
Botox in lower extremity, I think, has been well sort of documented. They can help and be an adjunct to what we do. In upper extremities, it's not so clear. So the best study was out of Wake Forest by a gentleman who's actually a hand surgeon. did a well-controlled study, 73 patients. And so again, this house of classification, again, most majority of these kids were in the middle, right? So they sort of had active passive assist. There's very few of them that had nothing, so 0 to 2. And very few of them had, you know, sort of full spontaneous use in 6 to 8. But so they injected the Botox or placebo, and they, so what they were doing is injecting the tight muscle. So it wasn't a fixed protocol. It's whatever they found that was spastic and tightened up their extremity. And so it was well done if they looked at it baseline 8 and 20 weeks. They injected it, and they looked at 26 weeks and looked at it all during that time and used an outcome study. We use a little different one called the SHUI, but it's basically this is an outcome assessment of how they did. And the conclusions from this study were that children that received the Botox into the upper extremity did certainly have a short-term improvement compared to surgery. Repeat injections were well tolerated and were safe in their population. And the conclusion was really bottom line is that for Botox in upper extremity, it's probably most useful in kids that are surgery is not recommended for whatever reason, because they can sort of get them out of that sort of fixed contracture, try to get them out of the rigid contracted position. And so we have neurologists at our hospital that actually injected. I don't inject it myself. I don't think they do. We have a very good neurology department that takes care of that for us. So we sort of work together with them. Surgery for me in upper extremity is a very difficult decision, probably one of the hardest things I have, because you have to always think about what sort of, one of my mentors taught me a long time ago, was this 2-4 rule. And so I can think of a lot of things to do to somebody, you know, to a child, but I don't want to do that. I want to just do something if I can help them, so something for them. And so, especially in CP, you want to make sure that you're going to be able to do something that helps the child. And so you always sort of weigh the scale, to me, of a risk-benefit thing. So the benefits you want to look at for these children is, can I improve their function? Another, I think, important thing is, as they get to be in their teenagers, is sort of position or appearance. So there are some children that, I don't think 10 transfers will work, but they have such a flexed wrist position that it's hard for hygiene, and they just don't like it being flexed in high school and things. So we make their wrist straight, refuse it. And those children are really, really happy, because that's really what they wanted, straight. But the risks of it, you always have to consider, because you know, there's anesthetic risks. You can actually make them worse. Mm-hmm. So if you make them really weak, they have less function. Like that's what, you know, Amy talked about. It's a problem with lower extremity. You don't want to make them too weak, it's hard to use. So you don't want to make them, you don't want to worsen the function. And finally, you know, they need to do rehabilitation for any tendon transfer that I do in upper extremity. So they have to be compliant with that, otherwise it's not worth doing surgery. They're definitely going to make them worse. So what I use is what's called the SHUE. So it's a Shriners Hospital Upper Extremity Evaluation. So it's a video evaluation. It's like the gait lab, but for the upper extremity surgery. And we haven't do tasks. I'm going to show you some patients, because I think that's how you really will understand. But it really looks for me at sort of range of motion, wrist grasp and release patterns, deformity, sensibility, and functional pattern. I think that, you know, certainly over the last few years, I've become very rigid about doing that for kids that are going to have surgery. And I think it is like Scottish right, at least in my clinical know that's what they're going to have, because I can go back and look at it, you know, 2 months from now, or whatever they're about to do surgery, and see, okay, we need to do this, this, and this. So basically what this means, or this wall means, is that we know that the problem is that the impulse is sort of being blocked, and it's not getting down to the arm. So even though you have muscle and everything in the arm, it's just an impulse from getting there. So they're telling themselves to bend it or to flex their fingers, but it's not getting there. And so that's really important, because, you know, it's really a CNS problem, and it's not in the extremity. So I think that one of the things that I want to make sure that when I talk to the children and the parents is that the parents have realistic goals about where we're going to take this in the upper extremity. So we're not going to be able to make it in most cases just like the other side. And so we got to, you know, understand that there's going to be sort of fixed goals that we're going to do and what we're going to try to do. The best predictor is really if they have volition and control of it. I really look for that in clinic to see if they are using it for tasks and on this sort of SHUI, how they use it. Because if they have good volition and control of it, they're going to do really well with surgery, I think. So again, the SHUI, and let me just show you some people who look at the SHUI. But there's, when we look at this video, it's done in a very regimented way that they get certain views and certain tasks and they get scored and how the positioning of their hand is and their upper extremity is. And it gets all tabulated like this by our occupational therapist. And it's a very labor-intensive scoring system, but it really gives us really good information. And again, the therapist and I look at it before when we determine sort of what to do with these kids. And so, this is a what we call PRFC. So that when it, we're considering doing surgery, there's certain tasks like opening a wallet. I mean, things that you would do as an adult or as or a child. So you kind of look at, are they using the hand that's affected? How are they using it? What position the wrist is in? What position their thumb's in? And to see in these little tests, and this is just a blurb of it, because the video itself, when they do it, takes about 15 minutes to do. The other important thing about it, I think, is that, you know, we have a bunch of nurses and therapists and fellows and residents go in with us to see a patient. And so when we see that child, their tone can be so high in the room, because they just are so, you know, everybody's anxious when they go to the doctor already, just compound that even more. And that's what happens. And so I think this gives them, this is just a videographer, the occupational therapist, and they're doing those tasks. And so I think this is a second good evaluation point that you can really see what they do when they're a little bit more relaxed. And so if you really look at them, you know, there's a lot of issues with that child when you look at how he did things. So in his forearm, he was in a pronated position, his wrist was flexed, his sort of fingers and thumb were sort of in a flexed position, and the thumb was in the palm. And so really, you know, we look at the patient as a total, but we also look at certain areas that we can sort of do things to help put them in a different position. So for the forearm being pronated or sort of this way, we sort of can do a pronator release or rerouting or slide, just something to get the pronator release. And then in the wrist, we can do several things. Fuse it, we can do a PCU, the SRB transfer. These are just tendons. So the tendon transfers to get the wrist in a better position, or actually the fusion. And the fingers, again, very much akin to in the lower extremity, you can either sort of lengthen the flexors. So FDS and FDP are the finger flexors. And you can lengthen them up, get them out of the palm with the adjunct that you may make them weaker by doing that. And also everything to slide everything out. And then in the thumb, you know, a lot of the problems they have is their thumb is in their palm. So you want to get it out of their palm if you can, because again, it has to do with grasp. And so the MP joint is this first one here. And if you have seen children with CP or have children with CP, you know that they sort of really get lax when they come into extension. And so there's things that we can do to stabilize that and sort of muscle these to get their thumb out of their palm and try to get their, give them more strength to bring the thumb out, so this extended thing. And so in that child, when I looked at his shoe, I felt like we could release his pronator carriage, which is this PT release, and sort of reroute it to make him be able to supinate his arm, sort of do a wrist flexor lengthening, something to bring his wrist up, and then transfer something that his wrist up strong, tendon transfer, and other things. These are just terminologies. But when we do that, and then you look at them afterwards, you can see, so his fingers are a little bit out of his palm, but his wrist can really come up now. And he's using it sort of in a better position for grasp.
How long after surgery and OT is this?
6 months.
I would say for both of us, 6 months is the minimum amount of time it takes to actually see some functional improvement. If you try to assess before then, everybody would just be depressed and dismal, because it just takes that long to recover from these surgeries.
If you sort of can compare it to the previous one, I mean, he's doing more things with his hand. He's in a better position. But this is just showing that. So this is how we scored afterwards. And the score comes out as sort of a, when the therapist uses it, sort of function, position, grasp and release, how they use it in their hand. And so when we look at this score, what they rated is really, they use a modified house. So 5 is the best, and 0 is no function when they do it. So moving from 3 to 4 is actually really, really good. And that's what you can expect, right? So you can't expect, and Amy, I think, stressed that too, you can't expect to go from a 1 or a 0 to a 5. It just doesn't happen. So if you go from a 3 to a 4, it can be dramatic. If you go from 2 to 3, it is dramatic. Sometimes you can go 2 levels, but you're not going to go more than that. And then so this child is one that came to us as a teenager, and he was really unhappy with his wrist position. He really just uses it sort of as a, you know, passive assist, but he just didn't like his wrist being down. He had undergone sort of a tendon transfer as a child at 6 years old, bring his wrist up. Many times what I find is that it's good to do that as children, because it gives them some period where they can sort of get their wrist in a better position, but as they get older, they sort of stretch it out. many times they have to stop very early, like at 6. And so they go on and they have that recurrent deformity. And the question is how to make it better or what to do to sort of alter this position. And so when they get to be that age and they get to be skeletal mature, like Amy was saying, you know, 16, 15, somewhere in there, and the biceps, the growth plates are closed, the best thing to do is to actually put the fuse to wrist. And so what we do with that is we take it into a straight position. They don't have any more wrist motion, but it puts it into a straight position. And believe it or not, the children really, really like it. So even though he doesn't have, you know, you haven't really altered some of his finger motion. I looked at some of his flexors in his fingers, but he likes it being straight and kind of push it against his side. His function is a little bit better than it was. And when they scored him on his function, they sort of saw his grasp release was better. Because it's hard, if you look at yourself, if your wrist is down like that, it's very difficult to grab anything. So if you put him in a straighter position, even if the fingers aren't great, still he's important. And then, just to show you, I mean, this is another kid that when we looked at it, we thought, okay, it's great what you would do for him in a shoe. And so he had something done to his thumb and his wrist. And this is the first child that you saw in the video. So this is the child that's going to do very well. I can tell you that right off the bat because he's got great volition control preoperatively, right? So this is one where his thumb is just a little loose. His thumb is in his palm and his wrist tends to be down. But he really wants to use it. Sorry, that was terrible. So that child, as you know, sort of already at 4 or 5 as far as his use of it out of a 5 scale, because he really, really wants to use it. It's just a matter of if you can sort of alter the way he uses it. He's not really cussing, he's supposed to be. But that happened, right? Besides, he wants to be. He does a little bit of, you know, that's part of it, believe it or not, is sort of high five, low five. Because it kind of shows in a playful way whether they turn the wrist over or not. So if you look at him, you know, afterwards, it's subtle, but now he can get his wrist is more sort of up in sort of neutral position to extend it better. Watch him when he has to use it to bring his thumb out. He's not able to bring his thumb out of it to really grasp on the pinch.
And what surgery did you do here?
He had a tendon transfer to bring his wrist up. Release of some of this in the ear. And his thumb was tight, sort of spastic and tight like this, so you release some of the muscle in here to just be able to extend it more and stabilize his joint here. Because it's very lax, it doesn't want to be prepared out. Now he's cutting an issue.
And I'm
going to
just say this is actually my son.
Right.
And we're in a year and a half
out,
and the progress is continual.
Mm-hmm. I think that's a really good point. You can make improvements for even up to 2 years after surgery.
He never had a real pinch because his thumb joint wouldn't hold it. Mm-hmm. And now, like, with this constraint camp and everything, he has a real honest pinch, and it's amazing.
And his desire is huge, right? So really, this is just reiterating, I think, what Amy said. It's really a multidisciplinary approach, right? So my partners do lower extremity, I do upper extremity with one of my partners. We have neurology that's there, OT, and everybody has to be involved. Otherwise, this doesn't succeed. And I think that's sort of what, you know, Jana has up in Plano is a multidisciplinary approach also. I think it's really good. So,
someone asked me the question if they went and saw Jan. Jan is great. She, like, does it all. And then when she thinks she needs Scatter Eye for a surgery, she just, like, emails us. And then we know the beauty of working with Jan is, and then we know that she's going to take care of all the therapy and the bracing and, you know, all of that, which is great.
Right. So I think, for me, that's it. But